If anyone is thinking of trying to address this issue and create change, and if you consider yourself rational, and if you consider yourself interested in data, and if you consider yourself interested in numbers, your first question presumably should be, how are we going to effectively reach more women?
The Rational View is a weekly series hosted by me, Dr. Alan Scott, providing a rational, evidence-based perspective on important societal issues. Hello and welcome to another episode of The Rational View. I'm your host, Dr. Al Scott. On this episode, we're lucky to have a popular environmental figure from Australia on the show to talk to us about his efforts to mitigate climate change and fight fossil fuels through a strong nuclear advocacy program in Australia where nuclear energy is illegal. It's Dr. Ben Hurd. And before we go to the interview, I'd just like to say thank you for listening to the program. If you like it, please hit like on your podcast app and please share it with your friends, talk about it, and come visit us at the Facebook group, The Rational View, where you can discuss with the experts all of your questions regarding the podcast. Dr. Ben Hurd is recognized as a leading voice for the use of nuclear technologies to address our most pressing global challenges. It certainly didn't start that way. Back in the day, he was a member of environmental NGOs and shared their basic objections to nuclear technologies. After completing a master's in sustainability, he worked in major projects in climate change, but there was just no solution on offer to match the scale of the problems at hand. So instead of continuing his objection to nuclear technology, he shut his damn mouth about it for a couple of years and did some learning. That was the start of pathway of writing, presenting, advocating, and ever more learning about how you can reinvent the future using all our knowledge and ingenuity. Ben was awarded his doctorate from the University of Adelaide in 2018, where he examined clean energy supply with a focus on nuclear technologies. He has presented his research findings at conferences around Australia and the world. He founded Bright New World in 2016 to provide a new organization for people who want pragmatic, compassionate, and science-based environmentalism, in particular, that values the role of nuclear technologies. Ben lives in Adelaide, South Australia, where he works in the private sector on energy and asset performance projects. He features as one of the global voices in the documentary Juice, How Electricity Explains the World. Ben, welcome to The Rational View.
Thanks, Al. I'm really happy to be here.
Thank you for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. You're a well-recognized pro-nuclear voice in Australia, and your work with Bright New World has been well-received amongst nuclear circles. I just recently heard that Bright New World is no longer. Can you tell us a little bit about Bright New World and what you're planning?
Yeah, absolutely. Bright New World was an environmental NGO that existed in Australia from about 2016. And that was our effort to contribute an organizational voice to these arguments. We had reached a point in Australia where I had been very active for a lot of years, writing, commentating, presenting, delivering, and had a healthy following. But then when there were processes that needed contribution and input, the absence of an organization actually was beginning to bite a little. And it was the guy who went on to become the general manager, Dane Eckerman, at one point during a Royal Commission in Adelaide said to me, you really need an organization because we really need your voice to have a seat at a table here, and you haven't got one. So it was an attempt to fill that role. And I was particularly proud of it because whilst it did have a focus on nuclear technologies, we articulated a much broader vision of building a brighter future based on what we know how to do in all respects. And the fact is, so much of that can be reduced to the availability of plentiful clean energy. That really is one of the absolute cornerstones of being able to build a better future for everybody. Meant that nuclear technologies was a big focus for us, as well as operating in Australia where those technologies were prohibited in terms of being an organization with limited means and wanting to have the maximum impact, for the time that we had. It was a strong avenue to pursue, so we pursued that strongly. Now, unfortunately, good things come to an end, and we we're operating in a very difficult context here in Australia in terms of that prohibition. It's a tough place to work like that. A generally weak philanthropic culture in Australia. And, you know, we put in several good years, but ultimately the voluntary labour that was behind it was unsustainable. So we are really proud of the contributions we made. We're really proud of being able to represent the very loyal people that were supporting us for a long time. But we've had to say it's time to end that. The good news there, I feel, is that the workload is shifting. The conversation is shifting. There is still going to be a lot of work happening in Australia and around the world. It's going to be of a different type now. So in the 10 years that I've been involved in the space, the conversation globally and in Australia has shifted a lot, and I'm really happy about that.
Yeah, you've had a significant impact, and I think your influence is well received. So what was there any particular event that caused you to realize that it's time to change, or what brought on this change?
There were a series of triggers that were working against my underlying position, you could say. Something that was informative was in the professional consulting I was doing. It was in the height of the Australian drought, the millennium drought, it was called. It sort of went from around about the turn of the century all the way through to about 2010, and it was extremely severe. And so Australia was needing to build desalination plants really very quickly to safeguard water supplies, not just in regional areas, but to our major cities. We were working on the Victorian desalination plant to serve Melbourne's water supply, and a government commitment had been made to make sure that plant was carbon neutral. I happened to end up being one of the main people who was driving the spreadsheet for just how that commitment was going to be met. That included all of the embodied energy and all of the materials in the concrete, and then, of course, the really large quantity of electricity that a desalination plant uses every year. Mm-hmm. And in Victoria, the power supply is predominantly brown coal, so it's as polluting from a greenhouse perspective as it can get. So running that spreadsheet and looking at the amount of energy for one new, large, and quite essential industrial facility and what it would require in renewable energy to offset the impact just helped to bring home the scale of the challenge for me. I'd been struggling up until that point to really get my head around how much energy society is consuming, mm-hmm. and where it's going and what it's for. And that helped me realize and go, oh my gosh, if that's just for one new desalination plant, just how big is this challenge? And I started sort of looking into that more and more.
It's daunting.
Yeah, it is. It is. And another was trying to do a carbon neutrality project. So carbon neutral was, you know, a big trend, a big fad in sort of sustainability and environmentalism. It still exists, but not as prominently as it was at that time. And so we were looking at helping a single facility gain accreditation under that for its operational emissions, its embodied emissions, etc. It happened to be a large car park in downtown Melbourne. And from that point of view, what I saw was the administrative challenge of trying to use those vehicles and those approaches to addressing climate change. And it was an incredibly high administrative burden, and not without reason, because you've got to verify those things. They've got to be really robust or they're worthless. You know, carbon neutral certification needs to mean something and you can't just hand it out. But the administrative burden of doing it for just one facility was really high. So I'm looking at sort of two of the three solutions that I sort of had on the table: renewable energies and carbon neutrality, that general trend, and going, this doesn't seem like it's going to be enough. In fact, by quite a long shot. And fortunately, I'd also had a little bit of information about nuclear that I hadn't completely rejected earlier in my journey. And so I just sort of, as you said in the intro, I just sort of battened down the hatches for a little while and stopped having such an opinion, took myself through a fairly deliberate process. And then there was a fairly catalyzing moment where I'd largely made up my mind. And I went to a debate that was being held at the University of Adelaide with Barry Brook, who was a professor there, a very well-known blogger, and a guy called Tom Blees, who wrote a book called Prescription for the Planet, has gone on to be, you know, very sort of influential. And they were presenting the nuclear case, and there were a couple of people presenting the anti-nuclear case. One of them was a man called Mark Diesendorf, who I had in recent years until then been referencing quite heavily in my work. You know, I'd been reading his books and referencing his work. Mm-hmm. And another man, Dave Noonan from the Australian Conservation Foundation, who was standing in for Helen Caldicott. So I got to watch these two protagonists go at it, you know, in front of an audience. Mm-hmm. And the standard of argument was just so much higher. It was so much higher from the nuclear camp. And particularly when I saw Dave Noonan really cherry pick a sentence from Tom's book and throw that out to the audience. And why that really got me is I'd been so antagonized about the way climate change denying had worked and the arguments that had been used in that and the fact that you can always pick back the threads, actually read the sources and go, you're lying, you know, or you're cherry picking. Mm-hmm. And so I'd picked up those skills from unpicking what was going on in the climate change conversation.
Right.
And then I saw the anti-nuclear proponents do the exact same thing.
Hmm.
And at that point, I really went, okay, I'm done. I can't identify with that anymore. That team's not my team. Can't do that. So that was a sort of important moment. And from there, look, I made friends with Barry Brook. I think he thought I was a bit odd coming up and wanting to talk to him about nuclear power, but he eventually realized I could maybe be quite useful, and we sort of double teamed for a few years and started doing presentations, and he was very influential. Ended up being the PhD supervisor. Yeah.
Oh, very good. What was your PhD thesis topic?
Well, we were looking at the role of nuclear technologies in clean energy in the 21st century, and we wanted to build up the argument towards that. The concluding chapter was doing some time series modelling of the Australian national electricity market, trying to demonstrate a low-cost, an optimised low-cost, very reliable, dependable and very low-carbon system, blending wind, solar, nuclear and hydroelectric technologies, leaving in some gas to do the a little bit of the load filling where something else was not available or was cheapest. So basically we spread the wind and solar all across the eastern seaboard of Australia. We took the time series data of the wind and solar, and we sort of went about it the other way, and we sort of said, we actually know that nuclear power could run Australia 100% on a technical basis. That's not in question. They operate that way.
Australia is a great source of uranium.
I mean, indeed it is. It absolutely is. So we wouldn't have any shortage of fuel, certainly not. And so we said, well, let's set the size of the nuclear sector at our peak demand. Now, that will be a very inefficient nuclear sector, and we'll have the model cost for that. And then what we'll do is we'll run it down increment by increment, you know, 50 megawatts at a time, all the way down to zero, and we will backfill in with amounts of wind and solar to cover the difference, and run the time series profile of that, and then we'll use gas to fuel what the wind and solar isn't meeting. And we'll keep running it all the way down to zero, and we'll ask the model to tell us what's a good cost optimal supply of that.
Okay.
Which turned out to be, you know, which was interesting, sort of looked at, you know, no matter how you push things around, it was hard to make wind and solar do more than 40% of the job, and that was taking into account we were pretending that we had perfect transmission all across Australia, and we don't. So it was a fairly generous model in that regard for using the renewables. But that was the culmination of it. I mean, the supervisors pressed me to really build up the case through the preceding chapters. So, you know, we wrote a chapter all about the South Australian energy transition. They asked me to look at what had happened here because we were moving quite fast. We wrote a chapter which became a very well-known paper called Burden of Proof, where we looked at the body of literature in 100% renewable studies, which was sort of had proliferated to about 20 or so studies. And I was finding that with each of these studies that I would read, the introduction or the abstract would reference other studies and create the impression that there was a coalescing body of literature that was ever more certain that this was the case. Or, you need to look here, there's this citation, this citation, this citation. Mm-hmm. So we came up with some criteria for the feasibility of those studies, and we put them all through a screening process and wrote a really well-received paper on that, sort of finding that actually, every single one of them is pretty deeply flawed. Some of them are high quality, but high quality in only one element and missing others. Others are just really, really poor. And also very internally inconsistent. So they would be speaking of a body of literature, and Some would be outright rejecting hydroelectricity. Others would be massively dependent on hydroelectricity. Some would be saying that biomass is unacceptable. Others would have enormous dependence on biomass. So it was actually a body of literature that's actually a fair bit of conflict about how to do this. And many of them beginning their analyses by assuming really monumental changes in the energy efficiency of society. So sort of rigging the starting point to suit the outcome.
Right. So you assume energy efficiency or loss of load requirements as your first starting point.
Yep.
And then you assume something else, whether it's Jacobson and his 10 times increase in hydro capacity for storage, or I guess he's got a new one out now where he's using electric vehicle batteries for his storage. And then you go from there, right? It seems very random. I haven't seen a case that holds together yet. I haven't looked at Jacobson's most recent stuff yet, but it seems to be they're assuming a conclusion and trying to find a solution.
Entirely. Look, that's exactly it, and that for me is problematic in all sorts of ways. That's a very high risk, low probability of success. I mean, if your first starting point is that you're going to fundamentally remake the world around you to suit your outcome, i.e., every building will get retrofit to this level of energy efficiency. Everyone will be using this car. Everyone will do this, and it's all going to happen really quickly. And even if any one of those assumptions, this is generally the case, any one of those assumptions would have some level of rigor behind its engineering achievability. But there's a huge difference between being able to demonstrate that something can be done on an engineering basis or on a physical basis and actually rolling it out society-wide. So then if you sort of have the combination of several of them that need to advance forward all together, often then creating interactions and interdependencies between those assumptions, again, to suit the supply system that your academic paper then intends to build and demonstrate and show as feasible, you've just completely departed from the real world. Like it might be a nice world that you've built in your paper. It's just not the real world. And as far as dealing with climate change goes, that for me is a hugely low probability of success. Whereas a nuclear power driven system works. It's proven amply. Proven and demonstrated to work.
In a lot of these papers, and I'm trying to keep abreast of the literature because obviously technology changes and cost structures change and new technologies come online all the time. And, you know, most of these people say, obviously you need some sort of a battery, some sort of an efficient battery to make a variable power source realistic. And if you can do that, then that gets past the feasibility issue. That says nothing about the cost effectiveness as compared to other existing solutions, and that's the next step in fantasy that you have to take. I mean, you know, it's like saying fusion power is going to save us. And, you know, it's been 20 years out for 100 years now. And you know, I can say that, yes, look, they're starting up much bigger fusion reactors and it's just over the horizon. Fusion is going to come along and save us and it's going to be cost effective because it doesn't have, you know, it all it uses is water, right? It's just easy to do. But no one should believe me if I say that because it hasn't happened. And there's always risks in scaling up to grid level. And we have a solution that we know that works. And there's only one that I think so far that I've seen that holds together.
Pretty much. When we were writing Burden and Proof, we were keen to distinguish between what we were calling feasibility and what you might call viability. And the terms get used pretty interchangeably. And we sort of worked on our definition to say we are trying to use a very tough and pure definition of feasibility by looking at the studies and saying, show us that you have shown your audience that this will work in a physical sense, that it can work. And so that was an example where virtually all studies at that time, now they've changed this and this has been changing the literature, I think, you know, largely driven by our work, were not thinking about frequency control in electrical grids. So they would assume a complete transition to asynchronous wind and solar generation, and they'd have no idea how they were going to stabilize the grid. They'd have no idea how they were going to maintain the inertia. The whole thing would just collapse and fall over. So it's not that that's necessarily physically impossible. There are ways of doing it. Batteries can contribute to that. Synchronous condensers can contribute to that. But they all add cost, they all add complexity, and they all add challenge. And what you're really doing is services that have traditionally been provided from one unit, just a spinning turbine driven by either coal, gas, nuclear, or hydroelectricity, providing a whole gamut of services to the grid, then need to be disaggregated into a whole lot of component parts and then rebuilt into a system. And they weren't doing that rebuild into a system. Now, for basic feasibility, you've got to show that you've mapped out how that's going to be done so that the system will hang together and will work. Because it's awfully high stakes to break that apart without knowing how you're going to put it back together again. Now, so on a feasibility basis, we know that nuclear works really, really well, right? We've got 100%, pretty much 100% nuclear grids out there, or very close to.
Decarbonized grids.
Yep. And some blend of nuclear and wind, solar, and hydro works fine, holds together. Viability is different. Viability, we're thinking, is more like, is there a societal tolerance for the expense, the complexity, the level of organization, the level of maintenance that would be required to actually maintain and sustain this system that's being proposed, which is a slightly different thing. Now, that might be cause to think about the viability of the incredibly large build-out of nuclear that would be required to decarbonize the world, both in electricity, in heat, and in creating synthetic fuels, et cetera, et cetera. We're talking about a huge quantity of energy and a huge nuclear build-out. Now, the rate of build-out of nuclear has been pretty rapid historically in some jurisdictions. Is it really viable that we would expect those to repeat? Now, how viable is that we would expect that to repeat in future? I think there are open questions there, and I think that's a good reason that we should be continuing to innovate our development of nuclear technologies towards things that are more fit for purpose and more likely to be viable as well as feasible in a broader range of markets, just to make our success against the climate change challenge lower risk and more assured.
Yeah, we need to be very successful with what we do to get to 100% net zero, basically. And in everything we do has to be, very successful. And then we need a mix. You have a much better chance of success if you have a diverse mix of sources, I think, on a risk assessment basis.
Yeah, entirely. And that is just a really, really curious artifact of those in the academic world and those in the activist world whose strategy appears to be a constraint of our options. And I'm pleased that in the 10 years that I've been involved in this issue, is definitely changing where that is a hugely contested idea. It's hugely contested in academia, in science. It's more and more contested finally, in some of the governance institutions like the EU with their recent sustainable finance taxonomy. Hmm. It's more and more contested in the environmental conversation. You would have people like Dave Roberts, Michael Liebrich, who would be, less enthusiastic about nuclear technology as a solution than I, but really clear to their critics on that point that to shut them down prematurely, to not presume that we're going to build them anymore is simply foolhardy. And it is. The problem, I'll tell you what, I was thinking about rationality when
you're in the right place.
I'm in the right place. I was thinking about rationality and people had often said, or they will often say to me, isn't it irrational? Isn't the anti-nuclear position irrational, especially if you're concerned about climate change? And it's often put in those terms. Having come from the anti-nuclear position, having come more from the traditional environmental position, I'm less persuaded that they are being irrational, and I am more persuaded that they're being dishonest with themselves and with the outside world. Because I think they are actually being quite rational in accordance with the values they actually hold, in accordance with the outcome and the sort of world they're actually interested in. I think anti-nuclear is extremely rational. If you make nuclear work, if you make it work in the fullest expression of how good the technology could be, you make a world where people can just use electricity, right? because it doesn't matter, because there's virtually no environmental impact to doing that. That's not actually the world they're trying to make. That's not actually the world that's consistent with their values. The values behind it are not a fairly pure, we must decarbonize. It is a much more encompassing view of how people should behave, how the world should behave, how society should behave, quite driven by a bit of a sense of people not being such a good thing on the planet, driven by a mindset of scarcity, that there is not enough, driven by a bit of a guilt about being human. And anti-nuclear makes a ton of sense in that point of view, because nuclear just, in a sense, it solves too many of those problems.
It's an appeal to nature fallacy, I think.
Very much so. Very much so. You know, the idea that we might have, fundamentally, most of humanity just getting on with their lives and not thinking too hard about climate change. That, for me, is victory. I think if we had decarbonized and no one needed to think about it, that, for me, is a win. But for sort of the mindset that I'd come from and the philosophy that I'd come from, it doesn't feel like a win because you haven't changed people's minds. I don't really care too much about changing people's minds about climate change. I just care about zero emissions. So when you're sort of on that train that I'm on, nuclear becomes incredibly rational. You go, well, that it works. It ticks so many boxes because I don't need to pull apart everything else. I can more or less just do a technology substitution, and a heck of a lot of the problems, air pollution, and climate change, are eliminated. Now, I call that progress, and I'm much more interested in progress than perfection, and I believe progress is an incremental process that with occasional large leaps, but ultimately it is always a walking forward process. It's not something we can hold hostage to every solution being solved all at once, or no solutions can be implemented.
And that makes sense.
So I think anti-nuclear is awfully rational if you get to closer proximity to what the underlying values are.
Yeah, they are not out to stop climate change. They are out to change the systems of society to match their philosophy.
Yes, and arguably climate change as a prominent issue came much later in the development of that philosophy and that worldview, and it is kind of a vehicle for the expression and the implementation of those other deeper values.
If we wanted to stop climate change, nuclear is the silver bullet. I mean, we would have bipartisan support on both sides of the political spectrum for a nuclear solution, and we could rapidly decarbonize if we wanted to, and if we could get everybody on board, if, you know, we get past that. That's a very interesting observation. I like your thinking on the rationality behind the environmentalist position.
Yeah, I mean, I've done the thought experiment and I've written about it, that nuclear was arguably invented a little too early. We got it a little before we needed it. Hmm. And, you know, if we were where we were now at 420 or so parts per million, a world running on fossil fuels, realizing we were cooking the planet and desperately needing to fix it, and then someone invented nuclear fission, I said, okay, how about this? The fuel's a million times denser, and this is just the first iteration of it. It can end up being 10 million times denser. We do have to mine it, but it's incredibly low impact. The waste product all remains contained where we've put it in incredibly small volumes, and it's plentiful and it's reliable, and it can be put just about anywhere. I think we'd have that sort of huge bipartisan embrace of that, but it's burdened. It's burdened, and sort of, you know, getting the burdens off its shoulders is, you know, part of the challenge.
So it must be very frustrating in Australia, where there is no nuclear and it's actually illegal, to be in such a position of knowing the answer and not having the power to implement it. How is the nuclear lobby doing in Australia? What is there any progress? Are there any cracks?
Yeah, there is certainly progress. It's born of pain. You know, Australia is now in a position where the world's energy supply is undergoing deep structural change, and we're not that well placed to benefit from it. So not only are we extremely dependent on fossil fuels domestically, we have an enormous fossil fuel export industry. And arguably, that's entering structural decline. Mm-hmm. We are also a free market economy, and our energy system is quite liberalized. And governments have been told by banks, banks that they invited into the party, but I might add, in the process of liberalisation, that those same banks are now turning around and saying there will not be finance for a new coal-fired power station in Australia. Right? That's not going to happen. We are not taking that risk on our books for future policy. So we've got a huge estate of coal-fired power stations that are aging, and they are heading to retirement, and they're being hastened to retirement by the influx of low-cost variable renewable energy. So we're heading for a heck of a pinch in our electrical system. The plan, if you can call it that, currently is a really, really big transmission build-out and to keep building renewables. I think that's actually just going to enhance the pain, because I think we're going to remind ourselves just how difficult it is to build very, very large transmission lines and lots of them. So there is renewed talk about nuclear technologies in Australia, particularly in the last 12 months. And this is because we are finding that, you know, having kind of no position on net zero is becoming increasingly untenable, particularly as China, Canada, the United Kingdom, the United States, Korea, Japan are all coming to the policy table with pretty clear positions on net zero. We're losing that excuse pretty rapidly. And that energy pinch, we are going to need to make some policy change. If you combine that with what I mentioned before about the availability of fit-for-purpose technologies, then I think we've got a genuine chance of some near-term policy change. It is reasonable to say that we might never build gigawatt-scale nuclear in Australia. There are some technical reasons why connecting a 1,000-megawatt single-generating unit or a 1,200-megawatt single-generating unit is difficult in Australia, and it relates to how spread out our grid is, how dispersed our population centres are, and the need to manage the loss of any single largest generator. So the largest thing connected in Australia right now is only 750 megawatts, and there's one of them. The vast majority of the units are 300 megawatts and below, and we've got a grid that is sort of built for that.
Very similar to Canada in that respect, in terms of the spread out population and the a few isolated areas that you know, just aren't served at all by grids. And right now they're on diesel. We've a lot of, you know, in the north there's a lot of diesel communities, or they're mines that are either hydro or diesel. And so Canada has gone into funding development of small modular reactors.
And I'm very grateful.
And a little bit.
Yeah. And I'm very grateful to them, because Canada and Australia are quite are frequently seen as quite parallel countries. We've got a lot of political similarities, a lot of governance similarities, a lot of cultural similarities, and a lot of economic and geographic similarities, except that Canada's a lot colder and we're a lot hotter. But we've got a lot of the same challenges, and we also have very large resource sectors. So faced with the same suite of challenges, Canada's doing that thing, and that makes for quite an interesting example. And it also, we're able to point out, and that is probably going to succeed, and their remote communities are probably going to have cleaner, cheaper, more reliable power. Ours won't. Their resources sector is going to have cheaper, more reliable power that's zero carbon, and so their export products are going to be welcomed into the world market more than ours. So the work that Canada is doing and the roadmap and the action plan there is I think making it a lot more achievable for Australia to have a policy change, because we will feel like there's a product at the end of that that is much easier for us to take on board and implement as part of our system.
Nice. We have to be very careful about saying that this is going to be the solution for remote communities, because many of these remote communities are native communities. In Canada's past, of course, probably like Australia's, involves a lot of land exploitation on unceded native territory.
Yep.
And nuclear energy has been tarred with that brush in the past. And I know people in the industry are working to include extensive consultations with First Nations and siting of future mines and the possible deep geological repositories that are being explored right now.
Yeah.
So is there obviously that's an issue that takes careful consultation and it can't be imposed in the top-down way. We need to talk with these communities and you know, explore their needs and make sure that what we're offering is what they want. Is it similar in Australia?
It's utterly the same. We have the added pain and trauma that nuclear weapons were tested in the Australian outback, in the outback of South Australia, my home state.
I didn't know.
They were. The British Army, you know, with the cooperation of Australia, tested atomic weapons in outback South Australia in a place called Maralinga. This was not done with consent. This was not done with due care. Australian Aboriginal people did suffer from this. So, yes, we have the same history of colonialism, same history of dispossession, same history of exploitation. And now we have communities living in remote areas where, ironically, you know, where there are less means, their power supply is, you know, diesel is expensive power and it's dirty and it's less reliable with needing to track the fuels in. So you certainly the idea of, hi, we've brought you the solution, is not appropriate, is not going to work, and has to be a bottom-up process of what do you want for the future of your community and how can this work for you? You know, and that's where, again, I am an optimistic person, but I perhaps hope that the development and evolution of smaller and yet smaller devices in the nuclear technology front offers the opportunity for different models of ownership that can be much more inclusive of communities. So you really might have community shareholder ownership, or, you know, we have corporations and representative groups for First Nations people in Australia. They might be able to take it on as actual owners and operators in their community.
I think there's a lot of appeal to the environmental groups too that we were talking about, and the politics of anti-nuclear.
Yes.
is a lot of it about the economic models of large corporations.
Yes.
Dominating the energy supply.
Yes, and let's be honest about that. That hasn't always worked out so well. You know, there have been and continue to be some pretty poor outcomes from corporate malfeasance, and the ability to have a more inclusive model of ownership is, I think, a real strength of innovation in nuclear. And I just stress, you know, the importance of process is so high and can't be overlooked. I mean, something we have made progress on in Australia is to site our low and intermediate level nuclear waste repository, because we do have a nuclear industry in Australia. We have a very good research reactor in Sydney that makes medical isotopes, makes dope silicon, does a lot of neutron beam research. And we have a lot of legacy waste arisings from scientific research earlier. And we have no completed waste disposal pathway for radioactive waste. So we've been trying for decades and decades to site a waste disposal facility. And in 2014, Barry Brook and I wrote an article in The Conversation, which was picked up really, really strongly, where we said, clickbait headline was that nuclear waste is safe to store in our suburbs, not just the bush. And the point we went on to make is we can't begin from a paradigm of our nuclear waste disposal facility will naturally be located in remote outback Australia, because why wouldn't you? We were saying, if we understand the hazards of this to be not all that bad, and we do, then it sends completely the wrong message to insist on sending to the remotest parts of Australia. That's actually screaming out at people that this is incredibly dangerous and incredibly undesirable stuff. If we know how to control the hazard, and we do, we know how to characterize it, we know how to engineer for it, then it should be able to be sited in any industrially zoned location in any capital city. And let's start the process from there. Where the process ends is a different matter, but let's start it being very open about the siting of that. Now, fortunately, what happened was the government was thinking the same way, and I was invited to join the siting panel for our low and intermediate level waste repository, and they ran a voluntary siting process. So we put our advertisements in newspapers all over the country, and we invited any private land holder with a suitable tract of land to offer it confidentially to the process for preliminary assessment. No obligations. Confidentially, just so that they could be involved in the process without needing to get too involved or too exposed. And if they wanted to proceed, we would then have a long list of sites. The response was tremendous. We ended up with, I remember the panel was having a bit of a poll, and we were thinking, oh, how many nominations do you think we'll get? Oh, 8, maybe 10. Mm-hmm. Double digits was feeling pretty positive. We got 28. So wow. There were 28 strong nominations from all over the country. It went through to a short list. It went through a long consultation process of 3 different sites, all of which had been volunteered from the landowners, and then the community did get involved, the local government did get involved, and it became a local issue, and they had the time to deal with it on a local basis. They had ballots to express their opinions on that, and we got a really strong response from a community in South Australia called Kimber that voted 62% in favour for hosting the facility.
That's great.
Yes, it is. It is. And the part of it was, you know, they were not under an obligation here. They were being presented with an opportunity from which they could genuinely withdraw at any time if they were ready. There was a little bit of upfront money brought to the community as a thank you, acknowledging that this is work we're putting you through. Things were not tied. You know, they weren't being blackmailed or held to ransom for it. So it's surprising what we do when we can run a process where we free people up from not feeling that they are being imposed upon. Then they take the time to really take the information in, and they pay very close attention. And that was successful. So I'm very pleased about that. We're still grinding out some of the last bits of politics of that, but I'm optimistic that will go ahead.
Wow, that's great. That's great news. So that's somewhat positive. I think this, you know, things are trending in the right direction, and even on a global scale, I feel like, you know, the examples of Germany and California and some of these areas that have, you know, shut down nuclear and have gone or tried to go renewable haven't really been working that well. I think that the carbon buildup is continuing, and they're not building it fast enough to make a big difference. So I think in general the message is coming through to the people that are willing to look at the evidence. But I'm really interested in learning, you know, more about, you know, the communication wizardry and how to properly talk to people who have these predisposed fear of nuclear, you know, because let's face it, there's been decades of anti-nuclear lobbying that has been uncountered in the media, in the popular media. So someone I talked to once said, you know, I think that, yes, there's a lot of anti-nuclear out there, but it's a mile wide and an inch deep.
Yeah, I think there's a lot in that. I think my experience would endorse that fairly well. Occasionally, it's a mile deep. You know, there's a few people in the Mariana Trench. There, you'll find them, but that's about right. My experience with Australians, particularly over 10 years, is there's actually a lot of curiosity, and a lot of objections are that inch deep, and the objection is actually really describing a curiosity. There's a lot of Australians out there feeling like, I think there's a lot more that I should know about this, and I don't, and I'm not really getting much of an opportunity, but what I think about this is this. And that's, you know, something that you can always work with. My experience has been, you know, if there are any sort of particular rules I would apply to this, is that we have to meet people where they are. We have to do our best to meet them where they are and go from there. You can't shout from a distance. And what I normally mean is try to find a way to connect on values. A values connection goes a hell of a long way. So knowing what your audience is it a community group of some type? Are you in a particular part of the country? What's their history? What do they particularly want out of the future? And this included when, you know, Barry and I would speak with rank and file members of the Australian Greens. You know, we were invited to some of their branches to talk about this. Naturally, we would lead very strongly with the fact that he and I are both in this, and we have only got to this position because of our overriding concern about the environment, our overriding concern about climate change is what's driven us here. And then as we sort of would work through what we're doing, and then it would move into the Q&A phase, some of that divide would open up between those who were a little more like Barry and I, and those who probably didn't want a big solution that would just work. And at that point, you sort of need to carve that off and go, they're probably never going to be fans of nuclear technology because it's actually not addressing the values that they're holding. For the sort of world they want to see. There's actually a heck of a lot of people that are in this middle ground where, no, they genuinely are concerned about climate change. They genuinely are concerned about air pollution. They genuinely do think nuclear power is still dangerous. They genuinely do think that nuclear radioactive waste is the worst, most intractable form of waste, and we should never, ever make any more of it. And there are many of those people who, if they feel that they can gain a relationship of trust with someone, they are happy to be relieved of those ideas. They find that experience good, where they go, you're telling me we can recycle nuclear waste. And we say, that's exactly what we're telling you. Yes, we can. It's proven. It's demonstrated. It's not commercial. And there are challenges to making it the dominant way of doing things. But there's absolutely a solution for that. Most people are hugely happy to hear that. But they aren't going to hear that until they have made a decision within themselves that I want to listen to this person and hear more from them or what they've got to say. And that really starts with trying to come and meet them somewhere at a place of respect. Diversity also really helps. Nuclear has not been a diverse place. The nuclear spokespeople haven't been diverse. I'm getting less diverse by the day. I used to be a young white guy. I'm turning into an old white guy. I've done my best.
One old white guy to another.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Okay. I kind of know that, and I made the best of my 30s. Let's put it that way. So we do need to be realistic about that and actively seek to promote and develop those people in the community who can speak more eye to eye with more diverse communities. I mean, I would point out it's almost uncomfortably simplistic, but the polling just points out such a huge gender divide on this issue. Every poll I've seen in every country where they look at the opinion about nuclear power and they include distinction in gender, there can be as much as a 20 percentage point difference between men and women on this issue. So if anyone is, and I was speaking with someone about this in Australia just the other day, and they were talking these terms. If anyone is thinking of trying to address this issue and create change, and if you consider yourself rational, and if you consider yourself interested in data, and if you consider yourself interested in numbers, your first question presumably should be, how are we going to effectively reach more women here? Mm-hmm. Because we can see that what's happened today hasn't really reached. If we really believe in this and we really believe it's the right thing, and we obviously there are many, 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 many women who are perfectly on board with that. The numbers say that too, but we're clearly not cutting through for such a large number. How do we address that? That is presumably going to come from helping to bring along more and more women in the space that can address that and have that first initial connection. It's not that men can't. That's not the way diversity works, but it certainly helps if we can build diversity into the communicators themselves.
Yeah, that's definitely a key, and it's why I'm very impressed with Zion Lights and her work in the UK, rallying the youth and the female, hitting both angles there. That's great.
It's a tremendous asset from that point of view. Of course it is. It absolutely is. And again, it's one that I'm sort of, it was easy for me when I was at university, right? So that's just a fact, right? People move into different abilities. I've now got ability to speak in different places, but what are we doing in the succession planning of this? I love that Zion Lights is doing great work. I love the Generation Atomic in the United States is is working on that succession. They're working on that generational basis because that's incredibly important and incredibly empowering. So this is good, and this has changed. That is great. The what we're talking about, communities and bottom up and process. Good Energy Collective in the United States with Jessica Lovering, Susie Baker. Thinking. Differently and creatively about the way to do these things. Isabel Bomeki, what a remarkable avenue of communication she brought through her TikTok videos.
Amazing.
I contributed some new ways to communicate in the efforts I've done, but these original ideas keep on coming, and that is so good, right? She's done things I was never going to be able to do. So this is tremendous. So building that diversity is good. And it's funny, we talked about the Inch Deep Malwad. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. there's another thing about pro-nuclear advocacy, which I've spoken about, which is a little similar. We can focus a little too much on building depth of commitment to nuclear when we actually need breadth. Getting this sort of societal change is more about broadening the support out across the populace into more groups of the populace, into different representative groups of the populace, until the point where it becomes a societal position and a no-brainer. The a lot of the efforts of nuclear advocacy that I have seen can often be about trying to drive people to deeper and ever deeper levels of commitment and excitement and dedication and to the technology. This can be really, really good for individuals. It can all, it also brings some risks of getting a little labored and misses the opportunity to go more broadly. We actually just really need simple, broad support. We just sort of need more people to go, yeah, why not? You know, I don't need to be a global expert on it. I don't need to understand fast reactors, pyroprocessing, and I don't really need to understand molten salt reactors, and I don't really need to understand. Yep, you know, that's not what I need, but I've got the basics and I'm on board, you know, and that's sort of, you know, that breadth that we should be looking for.
And no, I agree, and that's definitely what I'm hoping that we can achieve. So what's new for you? What's after Bright New World? How are you going to get this breadth of support?
Well, I'm probably going to take a few deep breaths for maybe a year or so. I've got, you know, personally speaking, exciting things happening, which is great. So I'm looking forward just to focusing on me for a little while. I do have some really good academic writing that I'm doing with Corey Bradshaw and a team in a follow-up paper presently. So I'm looking forward to seeing some more peer-reviewed work. Fortunately, you know, I work for a consultancy company, and the work that we are that is coming across our table is more and more overlapping with what I'm doing in nuclear technology. So as I say, that interest in Australia is building and globally is building. So I'm finding more and more avenues. That's the interesting thing, Al. If I've learned something in 10 years, the fundamentals don't go away, and nuclear is a fundamental. You know, with the challenges that we've got in the world, it's too fundamental to disappear. It keeps coming back. So I'll be speaking at the Climate Smart Engineering Conference in Australia in November. That's a function of Engineers Australia. I'll be representing my employer at that conference to talk about small modular reactors for Australia.
Oh, excellent.
What are the opportunities? What are the challenges? How is this still difficult? What work would we need to do to create the context to accept those technologies? So the nature of my work is changing, but I'm fortunately finding that I'm getting more and more mainstream opportunities to deliver on this work, because the appreciation that we probably need this technology is growing in those directions, and that's bringing terrific opportunities for me. So I expect that it's just going to become more and more a part of my day to day. And you know, if I could have known that 10 years ago when I first stood up in front of a group of people in Adelaide and said I've changed my mind about nuclear power, you know, if I'd said that, well, in 10 years' time, you'll be working, and you know, a few days of your week every week are going to be about that, I would have been an awfully happy person. So that's probably what's coming up for me next. But you know, the other thing I've learned is everything always changes. So check in with me in a year. There'll probably Excellent. Be something new happen. There are a few people I owe phone calls to. They might have some interesting ideas.
Well, we'll have to do that. I really appreciate talking with you this morning or this evening, depending on what side of the world you're on. And before I let you go, I have one question that I sometimes ask my guests.
John.
What's your favorite science fiction?
Oh, my God. I can't believe you've asked me that today. Okay. Oh, it could be the one I'm reading right now, which is a trilogy called Three Body Problem.
Okay.
And it's written by a Chinese author called Chichen Liu. So the first book is Three Body Problem. The second book is called The Dark Forest. The third book is called Death's End. I'm in the second book presently. And the scale of the ideas are wonderful. You know, it's sort of running all the way from the days of the Chinese Revolution to several hundred years in future. With some really dramatic ideas about human civilization, challenges we might face, the sociology of interacting with alien civilizations.
It's
really interesting. It is. It's terrific and it's fascinating. I mean, he's the only Chinese author I've read to date, and it's actually really interesting to read an English translation of a Chinese author, and you can almost get a sense of a different cadence to the language and the thinking, which I suspect comes from being an authoring brain that's learned to think and speak in an Eastern mindset more than a Western mindset. So they're wonderful books. So I'm gonna cheat and just also mention that unless this one takes the crown, my favorite science fiction book is probably The Wool Trilogy by Hugh Howey.
Well, that's great. Thanks again, Ben, for joining me on The Rational View.
That's been my pleasure.
If you'd like to follow up with more in-depth discussions, please come find us on Facebook at The Rational View and join our discussion group. If you like what you're hearing, please consider visiting my Patreon page at patreon.podbean.com/The Rational View. Thanks for listening.